desperate, who was generous with other nations, I had the caution, to qualify that, not to look at such a Jew, we are just the goodies, the good guys, and all the other the bad guys. I said that their generosity was in our own interest, in our own long-run interest, to have good relations with that country, and from there it could come good relations in investment, in trade, cultural exchanges, I don't know. So that's what I'm saying, but generosity in that sense. Of course, we have nothing to gain by sending, I don't know how many now, but at least with an average of 1,000 people, 1,000 military each time in Haiti. We have nothing to gain. Well, but Haiti is a country in our region. It's not in our interest if Haiti becomes a narco state, or it becomes a totally unruly state, or if it would be another foreign intervention of a big power in Haiti. So that's why we did it. So generous in this sense, though we didn't have anything immediate to gain from Haiti. We're not exchanging that for a piece of land, or we're not exchanging that for a concession on trade or anything like that. But of course we know that if Haiti is kept reasonably stable, and if its people can prosper, that will be good for the region. And I think that was especially true for the countries that were nearer to the complex question that I can't dwell about every aspect here now. Of course, corruption is very bad, but it's very good that the justice is totally free to deal with that. And that's what happens in Brazil, the justice, the police, the press, I would even say
inclusion between different countries, and above all, between the inhabitants of different countries. What do you think? Is it possible that this integration can be realized without a precise place like United Nations, and only between a network, social, political, and cultural, and economic network? Because you spoke about a principal umbrella visa, Brazil, India, and South Africa. But the connection is difficult because different continents. So how is it possible, this connection, with a network, world network, social, political, and cultural?
Well, the English acronym they call IBSA, we call IBAS. IBAS we call, but anyway, the English which predominates, they call IBSA. In the beginning it appeared to be just an idea, you know, three democracies, three in the developing world, the multicultural societies and so on and so forth, one in each part of the developing world. But it attracted a lot of support of university, of academia, of in the cultural area, and it also stimulated and encouraged bilateral relations. I think we have, structurally, one big problem in the problem of integration. This is precisely the connectivity. This is not easy because it's expensive, it requires big investments, and in most cases, unless you have a state that also invests, or any big interest that also invests, the benefits are not obvious. So very often to go to Africa, I have to go to Europe first, and then to go to Africa. Now, not so much, but it's still like that to a large extent. Not to South Africa, maybe, not to Angola, not to Mozambique, because I go to South Africa, but for other countries, it would be more normal to go to Paris or to London and then to Europe. And that's, of course, not a normal thing to happen. But I don't know, maybe it's a coincidence, but I don't know. There was this soothsayer who said in the United States, said, I don't believe in coincidences. So I don't believe in coincidences either. And the fact is that after we have all these summits with the Arab countries, we have Etihad and Qatar Airways and whatever flying to Brazil. We have even now, after the Ethiopian Airways, flying to Brazil. So it's very difficult to say what comes first. And I believe in terms of connectivity, it's more or less like the for those who are the economy, the law of say law in economy, that the offer, supply creates its own demand. So once you have the lines, people will come, more development will come. Normally that's the biggest bottleneck. But it's not an unsurmountable bottleneck. Of course, you can't do everything at the same time. So that's why when I had this first conversation with the Prime Minister, Democrat Minister, still Foreign Minister Zuma, he said, because she initially thought of a group of 7 or 8 countries, I said, no, let us do only 3, because this is a big symbol. It's 3 democracies, blah, 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 blah. And if that works, that will be an incentive for others to do. And I think that, for instance, the existence of IBSA, the existence of our efforts in South America, and other efforts of other countries, of course, not only ours, helped, for instance, to create the G20 of the WTO, which had a big role in WTO. We avoided a very harmful agreement in Cancun. When people say, well, Brazil, it's frustrating, Brazil and other countries are frustrating our objective. No, that was a very harmful agreement. Even export subsidies were not contemplated there, which was the most obvious. We still have to have a list of products and so on and so forth. And at the same time, big openings in the area of manufactured goods, in the area of services, in the area of government procurement, and not much in the area of agriculture, which was the basic interest of developing countries. And so we were able to avoid that. And to a large extent, not only, but to a large extent, thanks to these advantages. So I think these networks are creating, and one helps the other. We spoke of the IBSA, we haven't spoken of BRICS, but indeed BRICS became, because BRICS, the acronym was invented by, he's Lord now, Lord O'Neill, who is in the Bank of England. At the time he was in a more plebeian function in the Goldman Sachs. He invented the acronym, actually without an S, it was BRICS, but he didn't think of South Africa. He didn't have a political association. You could say, well, these are 4 big countries and so on. But it was us who transformed this reality, which was, let us say, only a virtual reality, because we had imagined this big country, not integrated, but a group of big countries. It was nice to have this acronym, BRIC. We transformed that into reality. And in a way, because the great majority of people are more interested in things that have more bigger financial weight, BRICS became more popular than IBSA. That's true, and you have to put up with that. The two are important, and they do have their role. For instance, in financial institutions, no doubt, the BRICS has a bigger role because it has China. Because it has China. Anyway, as India, Brazil, and so on, yeah, but China has a big role. But if you come to the Security Council, all the G20, for instance, in the Security Council, India and Brazil, South Africa didn't do that, but it regretted later on, were the two countries which abstained in the resolution on Libya. And the resolution on Libya was a total absurd. Not only absurd in terms of, because we had already the lesson of Iraq, of what happens when you try to impose democracy in a country by bombing. That doesn't happen. And at the same time, it was also an absurd because it said one thing, but allowed something else. It was said to be there to protect the civilian population, but in reality, it was regime change. Well, okay, if you want to change the regime, say so. But they were not clear enough, at least in the case of Saddam Hussein, they used to say that. Saddam is the problem. Okay, Saddam went out, and Iraq has a bigger problem now, and is a bigger problem for the rest of the world because of the conflicts that exist. So I'm not defending Saddam Hussein, but I mean, you have to weigh your work. I mean, and one of the problems that exists, I mean, this is already another subject, but one of the problems in the present world is when if you destroy state structures and don't leave anything in its place, you may have bigger and bigger problems. And Libya, of course, is very close to Italy, so you know that better than I do.
Ancora una domanda.
The atmosphere was that it was the biggest production of biomass that we have in the history. So in spite of the crisis, one thing was positive. No, I think this is, I'm not the, for a long time, ethanol was one of the main subjects of our foreign policy then because there was a discovery of this deep water, the deep sea water reserves of oil diminished to some extent, but I still think it's an important replacement for petrol and can help, but there are other things that can help as well. like wind energy and sun energy. I know Brazil is investing on that, but it's not a simple thing. You can't change one day to the other because it's expensive, it requires a lot of investment. So I think it's a balance. You have to make always a balance. And every form of energy has its drawbacks in one way or another. But we know that the future is not an oil. So we have to adapt ourselves to that reality. The future, when I say future, I'm speaking of 50, 60 years. So I think more investment in wind and sun energy, but also on things like ethanol, with caution, because of course we don't want to destroy, which is not being done, by the way, because ethanol doesn't grow in the Amazon. But the Portuguese have been there for 300 years and they were never planted sugar cane in the Amazon because it's not appropriate. So anyway, but we have to be careful to avoid this kind of thing. Ethanol consumes a lot of water, for instance. So anyway, it's not an easy thing. But I think we have to be aware of that. And I think we are, to a large extent. I think every small municipality in Brazil has its environment secretariat, and I think there are lots of, I'm not saying that everything is perfect, of course, in no country it is, but it is improving in that respect. But I think, coming back, if I may, to one of those questions of the political crisis that was made before, I think there is one problem, one big problem in Brazil, in the political sphere, which is the electoral system. The electoral system in Brazil makes election terribly expensive. And of course, if you have elections that are terribly expensive, I think the only country that's comparable is the United States. But I am not sure, even if in a per capita basis, if Brazil is not as expensive as the United States. And if you have an election that are very expensive, it's bound to have a big role for economic power. And economic power finds its ways in different forms. And I think this is a big source of corruption. I mean, it's not the task of politicians to change the soul of people. That's the task of religion or philosophers, I don't know. But it is the task of politicians to find ways that the bad side of people doesn't predominate. And I think the electoral system in Brazil needs a very, very important reform. And that's very difficult to have because, of course, normally it's the Congress that will do the reform, and the Congress will have to vote against the system. The congressmen have to vote against the system under which they were elected. So it's almost a kind of vicious circle. But I think if you don't have the crisis will be recurrent. This is a very big problem. Election, for instance, even an election for a congressman in Brazil is extremely expensive, not to speak of the election for president. And that, I think, is at the root of many of the problems that we have now.
Noi ringraziamo molto Celso Amorim per questa splendida lezione e anche per essere stato così disponibile a molte domande. Veramente grazie molte e con un calorosissimo applauso ai nostri studenti, vi ringrazio.